Just over 30 years ago, disaster struck a small town in Ukraine called Pripyat, just south of the Belarusian border. Arguably one of the worst nuclear disasters in history, the Chernobyl accident was a meltdown of catastrophic proportions. While the repercussions of such an event might seem obvious, you would be surprised to learn the truth. Keep watching till the end to learn about one positive outcome from the Chernobyl disaster. If this is your first time visiting our channel, please make sure to subscribe and give this video a big thumbs up. Today, we are showing you 10 unexpected consequences of the Chernobyl disaster. What exactly happened? Early in the morning on April 26, 1986, the reactor crew managing Chernobyl Unit 4 wanted to conduct tests on their unit. The purpose was to verify that the turbines in the reactor could keep moving long enough to keep the coolant pumps running in the event of a station-wide blackout, at least until the emergency generators turned on. The first mistake was certainly when the crew turned off the safety systems in order to prevent any interruptions to the power of the reactor during the test. They had to power down the reactor to a quarter of its capacity for the test, but something went wrong and the power went down to just 1%. Operators couldn't just turn the power back on to full capacity. It needed to be done slowly. They began to increase the power gradually, but a power surge interrupted their plans. With no safety system to commence the emergency shutdown, the reactor began to melt down. The fuel cells burst, followed by an explosion that caused the 1,000-ton cap on the reactor to be blown off. Temperatures reached up upwards of 2,000 degrees Celsius or 3,600 degrees Fahrenheit, causing fuel rods to melt and graphite to catch on fire. The graphite fire burned mercilessly for 9 days straight, sending clouds of radioactive smoke into the atmosphere and raining nuclear fallout across the countries of Europe. The disaster released more radiation than Little Boy did on Hiroshima in 1945. Geographic contamination. The most prominent radioactive isotopes that were released in the 9 days following the disaster consisted of iodine-131, cesium-137, strontium-90, and plutonium. Over 200,000 square kilometers of Europe were affected by the fallout of cesium-137, 70% of which fell within the borders of Russia, Ukraine, and Belarus. Agricultural lands were littered with radioactive iodine, resulting in contaminated crops, and even the grazing animals were affected by eating the newly unsafe grass. Additionally, the surrounding forested and mountainous regions fell victim to radioisotope deposition. Cesium-137 is very quickly absorbed by organisms and cycles rapidly through the food chain. Much of the flora and fauna around the disaster site were contaminated by radiation, especially mushrooms, berries, and game animals. The closer these organisms lived to the reactor, the higher the dosage of radiation they received and the more they exhibited signs of exposure, such as increased mortality rate and decreased reproduction rate. Some lakes, rivers, and water reservoirs were also contaminated by the fallout. Fortunately, this lasted for only a brief period of a few weeks following the disaster thanks to the process of radioactive decay and the absorption of initial deposition by surrounding soil. Even better, the closest towns and cities were evacuated quickly and efficiently in order to reduce exposure to external radiation. Much of it settled on open surfaces such as lawns, building roofs, parking lots, and roads. Much of this surface contamination is gone due to the natural weathering and the efforts of cleanup crews. The liquidators. The Chernobyl accident left a huge mess in its wake, and with such a huge mess to take care of, humanity had to pull together to enact a cleanup operation in order to prevent further damage to the surrounding area. Enter a group of workers called liquidators, who were people from different working backgrounds, often fire personnel, military police, or other civilian jobs who helped to reduce the damage. Their jobs varied from cleaning up the debris left over from the disaster, decontamination, destruction and burial of contaminated buildings and equipment, and the construction of the sarcophagus. This structure was essentially the tomb of the exploded reactor, hastily built from steel and lead in efforts to contain the leaking radiation and only predicted to last around 30 years before needing replacement. The liquidators were often informed about the true dangers of entering the highly contaminated area surrounding the site of the disaster known as the exclusion zone. While many of these liquidators were coerced into working for a certain period or sometimes past their designated period by direct order, thousands were volunteers who offered to work beyond their required service time. The exact number of liquidators is unknown, but it is estimated that around 800,000 Soviet citizens helped the cause. These workers had no idea the risks they faced entering such a radioactive zone, and many paid the ultimate price of death or lifelong illness due to exposure. Radiation exposure. While it's true that the Chernobyl disaster released a massive amount of radiation, civilians didn't experience a proportional amount of whole body exposure. This is due largely to the incredible evacuation efforts by the people of the Soviet countries affected by the radiation. The average amount of radiation exposure for civilians near the disaster is comparable to the accumulated amount of background radiation received in the 20 years following the accident. This is fantastic given the horrific results of the radiation exposure after the nuclear bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Workers put in an incredible effort to ensure the problem was under as much control as possible and that civilians living with a 30-kilometer radius of the reactor were evacuated to a safe location. The liquidators were exposed to the most amount of radiation, and researchers did seem to notice a slight pattern with adverse health effects following their aid with the cleanup. The average range of radiation exposure for humans from natural background radiation is anywhere from 1 to 10 millisieverts, the unit of measurement of radiation absorbed by the human body. For comparison, liquidators experience doses of around 100 or less millisieverts, evacuees experience less than 33 millisieverts, and residents in low-contaminated zones following the incidents experience between 10 and 20 millisieverts. The residents of low-contaminated areas ultimately accumulated the same dose of radiation over the course of 20 years that an individual would receive from one full-body CT scan. For a disaster this huge, civilians were certainly lucky to avoid acute radiation sickness. Childhood thyroid cancer. While general radiation exposure wasn't as bad as people might assume from a disaster like Chernobyl, there was a slight increase in cases of childhood thyroid cancer. The thyroid accumulates iodine from the bloodstream, a normal part of its metabolism. If there you are exposed to a large amount of radioactive iodine, such as the isotope iodine-131, this unstable substance can then accumulate in the thyroid gland and cause cancer. This is why if you live in a town within a certain radius of a nuclear power plant, you are usually mailed a stable iodine pill each year for every member of your household. The pill consists of salt called potassium iodide, which can help block the absorption of radioactive iodine in the event of a nuclear disaster. So how did children start developing thyroid cancer following the Chernobyl incident? By drinking radioactive milk. Yes, the fallout from the disaster spread across the grazing fields of cows and contaminated their food. The cows then ate this radioactive grass and passed on the iodine-131 isotope through their milk, which made its way to supermarkets for people to consume, among whom children were the most vulnerable to illness. Fortunately for young patients who developed thyroid cancer and even had advanced tumors, the treatments have been extremely effective, and these children have been given great prognosis in regards to their illness. Surprisingly healthy pregnancies. Obviously, one of the largest concerns about being exposed to radiation is about babies. Pregnancy, childbirth, genes. Will they all be okay after exposure? It depends on the dose. As we covered earlier, civilians really were not exposed to dramatic doses of radiation, certainly nothing significant enough to cause birth defects or issues during childbirth or pregnancy. This is again fantastic news given the severity of the disaster itself. As such, fertility in both men and women did not noticeably change. There was not a noticeable increase or decrease in the number of stillbirths, and there was no difference in reported cases of genetic defects or adverse complications to birth or pregnancy, at least not with civilian evacuees. A study found that the children of liquidators who were born after the disaster did have some genetic mutations. Their siblings who were born before the disaster were critical to this finding by playing the role of the control group. Essentially, the doses of radiation that the liquidators were exposed to was high enough to alter their germ cells, otherwise known as their sex cells, the sperm and the egg. Comparatively, however, the radiation doses were small, suggesting that even even small doses of radiation can mutate genes on the germ cells. Mutation doesn't necessarily mean defect. However, the results of these findings help to provide insight to how radiation affects reproduction in humans. Economic impact. It was not just the land and the people who suffered from the effects of the Chernobyl disaster. The economy, too, took a large hit, and not just the economy of the Soviet Union. Economic repercussions of the disaster were felt as far as the Scandinavian states, though obviously the Soviet states had the greatest losses. Hundreds of billions of dollars of costs were incurred as a result of the nuclear meltdown in Chernobyl. Directly, the damage caused by the accident and the subsequent measures for preventing the damages from growing contributed largely to the costs the Soviet Union had to pay. These preventative measures, including relocating civilians, creating a 30-kilometer exclusion zone around the site, sealing off the reactor to prevent further radioactive leakage, and providing all the health and social care needed for the victims of the accident. Additionally, many agricultural and industrial sites went out of use, taking away the economy indirectly, and the loss of the Chernobyl power plant as well was considered an indirect economic loss. Belarus later chose to terminate its own nuclear power program, resulting in another hard hit to the total Soviet economy. In total, the agricultural sector of the economy took the worst hit from the disaster, with many farms going out of business due to contaminated land, and still left unable to sell their remaining goods due to radioactivity. Psychological damage. While the physical side effects of the Chernobyl accident were few and far between for civilians of the Soviet Union, the rapid onset of events did put a lot of stress on the hearts and minds of the people. What resulted was a multitude of psychological problems stemming from a variety of factors. The hasty relocation of citizens, the loss of social contacts between friends and family members, the uncertainty of health effects and what the future held, all these proved to be damaging to the psyche. Three separate studies found that the victims of the Chernobyl disaster and resulting relocations have anxiety levels twice as high as those of the control group. The psychological ramifications found in the Chernobyl survivors were comparable to survivors of atomic bombings and other nuclear power plant accidents. Did you know, however, that even the words the media chose to refer to survivors had an impact on their psyches? The evacuees came to be known as sufferers or Chernobyl victims, terms which led the population to think of themselves as invalids, as weak, fragile people with no hope left, leaving a detrimental mark on their minds. They didn't see themselves as survivors simply because the media portrayed them not to be. They felt helpless and hopeless about their futures, for they were not survivors, they were victims. Environmental impact. Unsurprisingly, it's not just the human world that is affected by an accident on the scale of the Chernobyl disaster. The surrounding forested areas, as well as the wildlife that lived there, were also affected by radiation, particularly from the cesium-137 radioisotope, which recycles itself quickly through forest ecosystems. The highest levels of cesium-137 were found in food products, such as mushrooms and berries. One example of how this affects humans is with reindeer. The reindeer eat contaminated lichen, and then humans eat contaminated reindeer, which proved a problem for Finland, Norway, Russia, and Sweden, and especially for the indigenous Sami people who rely on the game meat for food. Mortality rates for the coniferous plants, soil invertebrates, and mammals increased following the accident, and reproductive rates for flora and fauna decreased. However, due to the natural process of radioactive decay, populations of plants and animals began to recover as soon as a year after the incident. Some genetic mutations have been observed in wildlife within the exclusion zone and even areas just beyond, though it is not immediately known if these mutations are biologically harmful. Amazingly, decades after the disaster, it turns out that the wildlife is flourishing within the Chernobyl exclusion zone. Given that it's no longer a popular destination for human interference and radioactive decay has lowered exposure levels to harmful radioisotopes, the zone has become almost like a safe haven for wildlife there. Chernobyl today. The Chernobyl exclusion zone consists of more than just Chernobyl. There are many small towns within its 30-kilometer radius, and several people work there with a small number of permanent inhabitants. While it's true that the zone has flourished with wildlife likely due to human inactivity, the zone itself is not totally void of people. In fact, you can even visit it as a tourist, book a room at the only hotel in town, and have yourself a nice sanctioned stay in this dangerous city. There are several checkpoints within the zone, and you may only enter with an authorized tour guide. Following your tour, you can even get a drink at the bar in town or pick a bottle up from the local supermarket before dropping off a postcard at the Seoul post office with one daily collection. Make sure you're back at your hotel by 8 p.m., however, or else you're breaking the municipal curfew. Avoid the local produce, even if it would be a cool story to tell your friends that you ate a Chernobyl apple. That's the fastest way to get sick. Don't get too excited about taking home any souvenirs either, because objects from within the zone are forbidden from leaving. You'd best remember that you will also be subject to radiation screening once your short trip is over. If your clothes are considered dangerous, you'll need to wash them or leave them behind. That wraps it up for 10 unexpected consequences of the Chernobyl disaster. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to go check out 10 creepy things everyone ignores about the pyramids for more historical facts. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.